Haven't figured it out yet by watching the video. This week is Camp Sunday. Okay, so what we're doing today is we're gonna act like it's camp. So we're gonna try that one more time, more like a camp appropriate response, all right? So, hey, we're here today, and today is Camp Sunday. There we go. Now we're in the right gear. I'm liking this. So you can tell by the one antlered moose. I just realized that while I was sitting there today. There's one antlered moose there. And things like this hanging around, which is the game trophy we play for. Some pieces from camp. But more than that, we're actually going to talk and show you what we do as far as worship and connecting with God while we're on the stage. So we've asked some special guests to be here, but I'll get to that in just a minute. First thing also, Tim Averill put that camp video together by dusting off his skills, so thanks, Tim, for doing that. So, I was the announcement guy at camp, but the announcement guy here at Union is Ron, so he's going to hit you with a few announcements before we begin today.
Ron. Thank you. Actually, I want you to know Lucas Jones is our announcement guy. I'm just filling in, right, Lucas? No, okay. And a couple of quick things, a few elder announcements. The staff and elders met together last week, and we talked about a lot of things. Still a lot of things to crunch through, but a couple of quick updates. One of the things we talked about was service times, and we have decided that there's a lot of pros and cons, but we're going to stick with our Sunday school at 9, church at 10 for now, because it seems to be working, and we're going to keep going with that. Of course, donuts are available all the way up until church starts, so please avail yourself of that. I heard there was a run on donuts when the kids started showing up, so that's good. Also, some people have been asking about the building program. Please know that's still on our hearts. It's still a desire, but we're going to give ourselves a little bit of time to settle out and see where we're at before we start moving forward with that again, but do realize that that's something we're still thinking about. Also, we talked about as we start a search for a new senior pastor, we haven't started that yet. We want to talk to you, see what we're really looking for, but we are looking at getting an interim senior pastor in the meantime, so we're going to start looking towards filling that as we then begin looking for a senior pastor, just so you know that direction we're heading. One last announcement along those lines is we are starting a new Sunday school class. I'm not. The Joneses and the Averills, and it's the below 30. So out of high school, below 30. If you fall in that age group or you're interested in a Sunday school class, please get a hold of them or get a hold of somebody, and we'll get you connected. But I also want to say this, under 30, out of high school. Did I say that right? And then we also have other Sunday school classes, and I don't know, John might be mad at me if I say this, but because I know we're pretty full. But if you want to get connected into a Sunday school class, please get a hold of us, and we would love to get you in that. And it's a great way to start building community and become a part here. So 9 o'clock Sunday school, 10 o'clock worship service. Following today's service, we're going to have a picnic. Please stay. If you didn't bring any food but you want to stay, we do have hot dogs and chips available. And we have a few loaves and a few fishes, but I'm sure it'll be plenty. We can just keep dividing it. No, I'm just kidding. That was a whole nother story. And then, also, the blue books, please pass those. If you are a visitor and you are comfortable with it, put your information in there. We would love to get a hold of you this week and just welcome you and say hi. If you are a visitor, welcome. Thank you for being here, and it's great to see you. Please enjoy the energy of camp and the Dietzels. David?
That's a perfect segue to tell you what's going to happen next. So we are going to do just a whole camp service for you, but we couldn't do a camp service. I mean, in the past, we've done a couple songs, and the kids sing up. They kind of do this, so they're not really excited about this, but I'm guessing having Pastor Paul and his wife Jessica here will bring a whole other level of energy. I don't know how Pastor Paul stands for 50 minutes on his toes, but you'll see this pretty soon. He's engaged at a level that just is kind of out of this world. But anyway, join us today in doing as much as you're willing to do, because this is what camp is all about, is connecting kids and adults with God and having an experience of worship that's just really powerful. So without any further ado, I'm going to turn it over to these guys.
Morning. Now you see, I didn't look up because I wanted to think for a moment. Your response would tell me there's about 10. I've always longed for that opportunity to speak or to share before a crowd of the masses. So I'm going to say it again, good morning, and you're going to echo back as that crowd of 10,000 would. Are you ready? Good morning. Oh, yeah, it sounded amazing. Hey, listen, we're so glad to be here to celebrate this camp celebration service with you. But we are going to ask you to stand. Stand up on your feet, and as David said, do what you feel comfortable doing. And I will tell you at this moment, I don't feel comfortable doing anything. But may the Spirit move, and we sing it loudly and boldly, and you're going to know the song.
This is the day you've made.
wasn't able to bring with me the large inflatable slices of pizza or the huge stuffed bass of many I've traveled with over the past several years. Today we have a noodle. Look at me and say a noodle.
A noodle.
Not one of those angel hair pastas. I'm more like a fat lasagna noodle. But nonetheless, we have a noodle here before you. It's going to start in the front row in a moment. In the front row with these ladies. They're going to pass over the head to the row behind them. All the way to the back. Where's it going, ladies?
All the way to the back.
You heard them. It's going all the way to the back. When the back and final row touches the noodle, it must come up again. It's down and back. Down and
back.
It's down and back. But no, wait a minute. There's three sections here. I can't compete with my wife. She's located on this highly elevated platform, as you can see. Usually you're sitting like this, looking down at me.
Now you're looking up. Now we're looking at you.
Things are looking up for me. Hey, Dave, let's give it up for Brother Dave Klein right here. Dave, I want you to have this section here. Miss Camille, give it up for Miss Camille. Miss Camille right here, right here, right here. All righty.
And yes. We need somebody in this front row.
The winning team right here. All the way down and back. The first one down and back wins. Are you ready, Dave? Miss Camille, you ready? In three, two, one, go! Ready, set, go!
I think we, is there a problem? Pastor Paul, is there a problem? That's what...
I see why you lose, Dave. I see why you lose. Miss Camille. Miss Camille down here. Slide over, Dave. They broke your noodle. They broke your noodle. Here we go. Ladies and gentlemen, get set. Go! You can almost tell why the chicken crossed the road joke on that one, but we're not gonna. We're not gonna.
Do you see all the smiles out there now?
Oh, yeah, we should have opened with that. We should have opened with that. I'm telling you.
You guys look great now. Oh, you look great.
Hey, a couple things that we've often, and well, I say more than often, every time we gather together, whether it be new students or students year after year, I remind them that I don't have rules. When they come together, they should have a quorum, a level of conduct, which is representing them as young students in Christ. Amen? We would agree that I don't need a list of rules on how to behave as one who's a follower of Christ. But two things I do ask for. Number one is respect. It's what now? Respect. You come into God's house, gather together with His family, members of your family, because we're co-heirs, are we not? Let's respect one another as such, that we're family together here. So don't be talking and having a conversation when you're distracted or no longer interested in what Miss Jessica and I are presenting to you this morning. That is showing disrespect to the people around you and to Jessica and I, and ultimately to who? God Himself. So let's respect our time together. Number two, I know, I say it year after year, 100% participation. And it's becoming more difficult for me over these many years. But as you can see, I still got it. Yeah, I'm gonna get it. I'm gonna get it later. It's gonna catch up with me.
I brought your sweat rag just in case you needed it.
I see the sweat rag lying over there. I don't sweat though. That's been a rumor. It's true, isn't it? Yeah, this might in fact be the camp that gave me the name Sir Sweats-a-Lot. I'm not quite sure where that name came from, but nonetheless, there may be a bead of sweat. That's because I'm moving, I'm doing, I'm jumping, I'm singing with all that I have. I want you to stand your feet and sing this camp song with me. Oh, you're gonna love it.
All my life, all I love, God's been good to my soul. Mountain high, valley low, I'm unseen where
except for Chicken King.
Yes.
Come on down, my friend, the Chicken King. Let's give it up right here. Come on down, come on down. Yeah. When one specifically picks out their attire for the day, their wardrobe, many of you have done that your first day of school. I appreciate your thoughtfulness in wearing the shirt that I pride so much in, that Chicken Whisper. Here's what you're going to do. You're going to compete in a game I like to simply call the game of no skill. Come on, look at him and say, no skill.
No skill.
That's why he got into raising chickens. Anyway, never knows. Sure takes a lot of work, a lot of work. I got three in the backyard. No, the neighbor does, but they often. Well, and nonetheless, here we go. The game is quite simple. In a moment, you're going to raise a hand either left or right. You see, it requires no skill. Either left or right, you're going to lock your elbows in place and point your fingers in that direction, either left or. It's quite simple. Turn around and face the screen, sir. Here you go. You got occupations. I'm sure that of a chicken rancher isn't there, but zookeeper comes close. All right. You're going to choose either a zookeeper or a librarian by taking your arm and stretching it out left or right with fingers fully extended. Let's see what you got here. Now, he chooses the librarian. Now, in a moment, one of these two images is going to vanish from the screen. If you're pointing at the librarian, of which you are, and it vanishes, you're out of the game. The game ends early for you. But again, it required no skill. Required no what?
Skill.
And this is why I've chose you today. Here we go. What is it, Miss Jessica? It is the... Oh, you're in the game. You're in the game. He's in it to win it. Should he do another round?
Yeah.
Of course he should. Choose now. Is it going to be the baker or the chef? By the way, he's serving chicken Gordon Bleu.
They're not the same.
It's the same thing, I know. Zookeeper, chef. You always wonder what they do with the recycled. Never mind. Here we go. Ready? Is it the chef? Oh! Wah, wah, wah. Zero skill. Maybe you can do better. You think you can do better?
Yeah!
All right, if you wish to participate, you know how the game is played. Stand up on your feet. Stand up on your feet. Here we go. Here we go. Here we go. Take your arm and stretch it out, either artist or architect. Artist or architect. If you chose the one that disappears, you're out of the game. In 3, 2, 1, artist. Sit down, artist. We lost a lot of kids. You see where they're thinking. Are you ready? Photographer or contractor? Photographer or the contractor? Choose now, left or right, photographer or contractor. In 3, 2, 1, oh. Contractor's gone. He's out of here. Whoa. We lost a lot. Choose again. Is it going to be the rock star or the waste management professional? The waste management professional. Here we go. Ready in 3, 2, 1. Yeah. Rock stars. Take
dropping
a seat.
Like flies.
All right. Is it going to be the painter or the veterinarian? The painter or the veterinarian? Alrighty, in 3, everybody's chosen. 2, 1, and it is the... Oh, the veterinarian must have a seat. Have a seat, veterinarians. Oh.
Let's bring them forward, Pastor Paul.
Oh, wait a minute. We got 4 over here. We got 2 here and 2 over here. 3. I didn't see you there, young lady. Oh, you too. Are you ready? Let's try it again. Here we go. Choose now. Astronaut or pilot? Astronaut or pilot? Alrighty, in 3, 2, 1. Pilot's out of here. All right. Who remains? Who remains? Anybody on this side remains? Nobody here? No. Are you kidding me? You two? You
right
grew.
Here, this little guy's in. You come forward. Are you in?
I remember you. Never mind. I remember you when you're that size. All right. Are you going to compete against Kyle? Is it this? Is it? Only 2? 2 remain? 3? Where's the third? Oh, I'm sorry, you're hiding in the shadow. Alrighty, good. Alrighty. You ready? Look up at their screen. Look here at the screen. We got 3 remaining. We don't want to leave anybody out. Is it going to be the waiter or the judge? Waiter or the judge? Waiter or the judge? Choose. Alrighty. Ladies and gentlemen, we got 2 who chose the waiter and 1 here in the middle who chose the judge. The answer is... Oh, I'm sorry. We're down to 2 now. This is it for the win. To claim the victory, is it going to be the optometrist or the surgeon? The optometrist or the surgeon? Choose. You both chose the optometrist, I see. Oh, should he change his mind? If the optometrist vanishes, nobody wins the game. Ladies and gentlemen, the answer is... Oh! But let's give them both a big hand. They tied for first. Now, I know we've been up and down, and, well, there's a reason to that, yeah. You're less likely to fall asleep if you have an increased heart rate in a little bit. See what I'm saying? We try that. But then feeding kids a huge dinner and bringing them to service doesn't work either. Would you stand on your feet and sing the song we all know and know well?
In the presence of my enemies.
Oh, let me hear you belt it out now. I sing a hallelujah.
I raise a hallelujah.
Standing and sitting and singing and participating in games to test your knowledge. School started for you just what, last week, a week before? 2 weeks? You've already been in school 2 weeks. Michigan, we don't start till later this week. I know that specifically. I'm a sub bus driver. I've been very much informed that another medical leave has been submitted by a full-time driver. I know what that means. 8 months on the road. Anyway. I don't know how you get 8 months off for medical leave. I don't understand it. I want medical leave, okay? That's what I want. I want a medical leave. Whatever that looks like, I'm gonna take one. It's time to test your knowledge, your infinite wisdom, by asking you a question regarding fast food. Fast food. If you think you know the correct answer, raise your hand. Which introduced the first drive-through window? Was McDonald's, Sonic, Burger King, or Wendy's? Who introduced the first drive-through windows? If you think you might know the answer, raise your hand. If not, I'll choose you. Here you go. Wendy's. He says Wendy's. I'm gonna have to agree with you on that one. Is it Wendy's? Yeah, we got a winner, winner, winner. Look at that. Many of you, you were thinking McDonald's, weren't you? Now you know how this game is played. Which was founded first, Burger King, Taco Bell, Dunkin' Donuts, or Subway? Which was founded first? If you think you know the answer, raise your hand. Oh, I got a hand up right here. Look at you. What is it? What is it?
Burger King.
I don't know either. Is it Burger King? No, Dunkin' Donuts was founded before Burger King. I wouldn't have thought that, would you have? I wouldn't have thought that. Here we go. How many herbs and spices are in the KFC recipe? So you might remember the old jingle, the old song. The old, I have to go back. See, when I said old, I have to continue back here, don't I? Whoa, okay. Did you color this or is it natural? It's pretty natural. So is mine. Are you ready? How many herbs and spices are in the KFC recipe? 13, 11, 9, or 7?
No idea. Two.
Oh, no. Two is not an option, but two. No. Two, yeah. Number two, 11. He says 11. Is it 11? 11 herbs and spices. Yeah, you still got it. That must be natural. We who become great tend to lose our memory first, or old jingles. Here it is. Which was the most... Which has the most locations in the U.S.? Dunkin' Donuts, McDonald's, Subway, or Starbucks? Oh, let's go up here, young lady. What do you think this one is? Which of these have the most locations?
Starbucks.
Is it? I want to differ with you on this one, but I do like the fact that Starbucks could have a lot. Is it Starbucks? Subway, you got it right. You got it right. I heard you.
Three.
What is the most common pizza topping? Ham, extra cheese, bacon, or pepperoni? The most common pizza topping. You say pepperoni? Are you conferring? No. You're disagreeing. Oh, good. We have a little sibling rivalry here. That's not your brother? All righty. You just look so good. You're young and spry. What do you say it is, sir? Cheese. He says cheese. You say pepperoni. The correct answer is pepperoni! Rub it in, rub it in, rub it in right now. Let him have it. Yeah. Here's a question for you. What is the best seller on the McDonald's menu? Is it cheeseburger, Big Mac, French fry, or milkshake? What is the best, most common seller? I'm going way over here to a sheepish little raised hand. Like, I know the answer. I've seen that.
French fries?
I might agree with you on this one, sweetie. Is it French fries? Yeah! I knew it. That's why I came here. How many pizzas does Domino's sell every year? 1 million, 3 million, 6 million, or 12 million? Oh, what'd you say? 20 million, or 12 million. 12 million. Is it 12 million pizzas every year? What? Wow. I think it was way off. I think it missed the boat on that one. It's already docked on the opposing shores. He's like, whoa. I just missed it. Which makes the most money? Domino's, Chick-fil-A, Wendy's, or Taco Bell? Which makes the most money? I got a little hand up way back here. Look at. Which makes the most money of the ones seen?
Chick-fil-A.
Chick-fil-A. Have Chick-fil-A's arrived yet in your area? They have? Okay. Michigan's just now getting them. You know, we're late on everything. We're late. Is it Chick-fil-A? Yeah! Nicely done. Nicely.
Last question, Pastor Paul.
The last and final question. What were chicken nuggets first called? Oh. Well, you know what? We got to defer to the Chicken King. Yeah. Of your little backyard birds, of your yard fowl, you should know this.
I didn't know.
This is we set this up. We did this for you. Is it Chicken Krispies, Nuggy Nuggets, bite-sized chicken, or chicken tenders? What was the first chicken nugget called? Chicken Krispies, Nugget Nuggets, Nuggy Nuggets, bite-sized chicken, or chicken tenders?
Well, at our house, we call them Dino Nuggies because they're
Dinosaur.
It's not an option.
It should be.
I know. But I rigged it.
I'm going to go with Chicken Krispies.
Chicken Krispies. How many of you want to agree with them, Chicken Krispies? Let's just see how many are here in support of Chicken Krispies. How many think it's Nuggy Nuggets? Couple, three, four, eight, 12 of you maybe. How many think a bite-sized chicken? Look at the hands. Oh, my goodness. You call that a banny, I think. And chicken tenders. Couple of chicken tenders. Is it Chicken Krispies? Yeah! Hailed as the Chicken King, ladies and gentlemen. Oh, there's none wiser, no, not one. Second Hezekiah, 4:11. None wiser, no, not one. Oh. I don't even know where I put notes, if I even have prepared any this morning. Because I got to be real with you. I got to be what with you?
Real.
Come on, I got to be real with you this morning. I don't know why I'm here. No, seriously. I mean, I know why. I'll explain that in a minute, but I kind of began camp this year with the students that are with us. I began that way saying, I don't know why I'm here. I'm busy. Now, if I were to ask a census, a survey taken of everyone in this place, how many of you have had a busy week? I dare say a lot of hands would probably go up. We live busy lifestyles, do we not? We're busy. Things are stacked on top of each other. Parents are dropping a student off here and picking up another one there. And in their absence, they're lining that up because they have to work. And not just 40 hours a week, but 60 plus. We're busy people, are we not? I don't know why I'm here. Just to be real with you. Just to be real. I don't know why I'm here. Because I'm busy. I could go head to head, toe to toe with any of you who said you had a busy week. And I would dare say, and I'm not speaking as one of arrogance or pride, but this week has been busy. Every minute, the past 72 hours has been booked. When I say every minute, the departure times, the arrival times, when we'll stop, how long we can stay at that stop. How long is it going to take me to put 16 gallons of gas in the car that's now driving on fumes? Every minute of the past 72 hours and every minute of the next 72 hours of my life is booked. Upon leaving here today, I have to travel to St. John's in Benton Harbor to do another event for a church there and then drive 2.5 hours home. To drive then an hour north to pick up my van and trailer, which was stranded at a previous event last night. To arrive back Monday evening to do another program for a school near us, and then Tuesday morning begin the launch of our ice cream shop, of which has taken my wife and I 4 years of, when I say blood, sweat, and tears, I mean blood as well. They pay well for plasma. For 4 years, we've put everything into this place, and Family Life Radio on Tuesday, we'll be broadcasting live from our facility as it opens Tuesday. So when I say I'm busy, I'm
busy.
I just want to be real with you. Why am I here? Why? Why am I here? My wife said I received a phone call, text, or message from Camille, and Camille's requesting our attendance and presence here at an event. They're wrapping up the summer. They want a camp-themed Sunday service, and they would think of none other than the person who spoke for many, many years to be there and share with our students and families what they had learned at camp, not just this year, but even in the years past. I look up from where I was sitting. It's probably checking off those little boxes that I put beside things that need to get done the next day, and that list is continuing, and I'm like, oh, really? We had to drive to... What is this place, Huffington? I don't know. She told the GPS. We got here. We got here because I said yes. I said yes to Camille's request given to me by Jessica sometime while sitting there weeks ago, and I said yes, thinking, how is it even possible? You see, something within me, one might call it a deep inner urge. A deep, powerful inner urge caused me to say this three-letter word, yes. I contemplated that decision many hours after, thinking maybe we should just tell her no before any promo has gone out, before any advertisement or word spreads of our arrival. Maybe we can cancel this thing. But I said yes, we can go, because of a deep inner conviction or urge to say yes, to say yes. I'm just being real with you. Oh, by the way, that was our theme this year, to be real. What is real? Are you real and genuine, authentic? Just be real with ourselves, with others, and with God. Just be. I want us to read our text. It's in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 14 through 17. Now, I know kids didn't bring their little backpackies or whatever you call them, little rucksacks they bring with them to service, and Bibles get flipped open, and then we spend the next 2.5 to 4 minutes trying to find the text. And I've said year after year, your camp of only a few of the tens of thousands of students that I've had the privilege and the honor to speaking to have ever brought their Bibles to service. I want to thank you as parents for not just packing the Bible, but encouraging your kids to carry it to service and to chapel. You cabin leaders who have worked tirelessly to help your students find passages, thank you so much that they know God's word. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 14 through 17, for Christ's love compels us because we are convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died. And he died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again. So from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view, though we once regarded Christ in this way, we do so no longer. Verse 17, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come, the old has gone, the new is here. Very few camps have a theme verse of which has four verses in it. It's usually quite simple, and we can commit it to memory quite easily. And this one was a little harder. For myself, and I'm sure many of you cabin leaders who tried to stay on point. But before we go any further and look into this verse this morning, I want you to imagine with me for a moment a 50-pound round weight. Now, if you know what a 50-pound round weight is, it's what those weightlifters or those conditioning themselves, perhaps football this fall, they'll work out on the bench or they'll do a deadlift. They'll put these huge round weights on that. Well, you wouldn't know. Let me talk to someone who does. You know what I'm saying, don't you? You've had many occasions where you've lifted that dumbbell with those big, huge, imagine a 50-pound round weight here on stage. It's located at this edge of the stage right here. And I would ask a student, perhaps this young man, come here. Can you help me for a second? And I would ask Graham. Graham, imagine with me for a moment. Can you move this 50-pound round weight from this edge of the stage to the other? No. He even knows that because he's probably 30 pounds soaking wet. Am I right? He looks at, there's no way I could lift that. And if I were to slide it off the edge of the stage, it would crush me. I'd form a puddle on the carpet beneath me. It's too much for me. And it'd be too much for many of your small students, wouldn't it? A 50-pound round weight, firmly pressed against the carpet with no place to grab, no place to put your fingers. But wait a minute. Graham and even others, if I were to take that 50-pound round weight and break it down into two 25-pound weights, it's likely a few of you could do it. Do it easily. Transfer it from one end of the stage to the other. If I had 5 10-pound weights, it's the same amount of weight as 50 pounds, but now it's 5 10-pound round weights. It's likely that Graham could do it and many others. Struggle a bit, perhaps, to pick it up, but they could lug it and carry it, drag it even to the other side of the stage. Make it even simpler. What if I had 10 5-pound weights? Even you could do it. It's likely we could juggle them, am I right? Put one in our pocket. Carry one in each hand. Even the smallest of students could transfer 50 pounds of weight, 10 5-pound increments to one side of the stage or the other. Am I correct? Oh, wait a minute. Maybe I lost you a little bit on all the math. I mean, after all, I'm in Huffington, right? Oh, it's Huntington?
Yes, sir.
Huffington scored higher on the state exams, I'll just tell you. You're in trouble. Maybe I lost you on the math. What if before you was a 12-ounce perfectly cooked steak? You know, that, nice sirloin steak perfectly cooked. And you've been fasting since 9, and you're hungry. I mean, you're so hungry, you look at that steak and you go, I could eat that in one bite. Now I know, and many know, in your arrogance, you're saying, yeah, I could eat that in one bite, I'm so hungry. No, you couldn't. Now, could you shove it in your mouth? Likely. But you'd have to chew it, you'd have to break it down into increments of which its size could pass easily down your throat, and then in order to digest it even beyond that, it has to be broke down even more. On the micro level, you have to chew it and grind it and then swallow it, that you could get everything out of that piece of nutrient possible. Am I right? You see the problem that many preachers, teachers, not just of adults, but of children have? And dropping a verse or a passage of scripture like this and saying, okay, now read it, understand it, and retell it or regurgitate it to me in a way that I too can understand. It's difficult. Say it's difficult. I think we all can agree, can we not? That's why we have to take God's word and break it down. This passage is heavy, like a 50-pound round weight. It's heavy. It's weighty, is it not? There's a lot there. And there's a lot to ingest, a lot of nutrients found within that passage. But for us to get everything we want out of it, we have to look at it incrementally. I don't want to break the whole thing down this morning. And I've told you, students, last year and repeated again this year, when we study God's word, words have meaning. What has meaning? Every word has meaning. Remember that context is king. Who wrote it? To whom was it written? When and why? It has a lot to do with when we study God's word. Who wrote it? To whom? When and why? Ask yourself those questions. Look into that. And then whenever you have a thought or God is speaking to you through his word or so you think, make sure that scripture interprets scripture. You might have a thought on a verse that's not correct, but as you begin to study God's word, you find other scriptures that either correct you in your thinking or affirm the thought that you're having regarding that passage is absolutely correct. Scripture interprets scripture. Words have meaning. Context is king. Scripture interprets scripture. And look for the grace and the glory of Jesus Christ. He is revealed from the beginning to the end. From the beginning to the of God's word, the grace and the glory of Jesus Christ is evident. So back to verse 14. The letter of Paul to a church in Corinth. The second that we have recorded, but some theologians believe there's up to four. Two of which are missing, and oh, how we hope to find those one day. They're referenced and referred to other times, but we have this letter. We have this letter to the church in Corinth where Paul affirms to them who he is and who they are in Christ and tries to encourage them as believers. He says, for Christ's love compels us. Stop right there. Say stop. Like I said, we got to chew on a little bit. We got to break it down. Did I mention a moment ago? I believe I did. Camel's invitation, her request for us to be here. I said, yes, I reluctantly, and wanted to retract it many times, Camille, but I said, yes, I'll be here. I was compelled, I said, to say yes. Something within me, that deep inner urge. That's what compel means. What does compel mean? I believe Jessica has a definition for compel. Yes, you do. Look at me and shake your head. No, I know. You do. Compel means a powerful inner urge, necessitator to oblige. I had a powerful inner urge within me upon the request of our presence to say yes. Many of you have been compelled to do something. You've had that deep inner urge. Paul had it, Timothy as well, and those who followed and worked and served alongside of Timothy in his ministry, they were compelled to do something, and that was to share the message of the hope of Jesus Christ, the gospel. Of which you see before that word compel, Christ's love. What is it that compelled Paul? Christ's love. I'm going to ask you again, what was it that compelled Paul? Christ's love. Paul had experienced Christ's love. Paul preached of Christ's love. Paul knew of Christ's love because in that while Paul was yet a sinner, Christ died for him. If you don't believe me, he wrote it down in Romans chapter 5, verse 8. In Romans 5 and verse 8, for this reason, or for this cause. Allow me to read it to you. Now, where's my phone, which is my Bible all in one? Am I right? Yeah. Of which I have 1% on my Bible. That's not good. I'm going to have to wing it. Here's what it says in Romans 5, 8. But God demonstrated his own love for us. He's speaking of himself. Himself is included here. Christ demonstrated, or God demonstrated his life for us, and that while we were yet still sinners, Christ died for us. So what is it that has compelled Paul? It's Christ's love. Paul knew that I'm a sinner, a wretched sinner. I have a past. I have sins that haunt me. I have a thorn in my side. Paul speaks of his past, and he knows what God has done for him, that it was because of Christ's love. When he gave his life upon the cross, when he bled and died, when he was buried in a tomb, put to death, covered by dirt, and then yet rose from the grave. That stone was rolled back. He ascended into heaven. He overcame sin and death. He would be the price for the penalty of our sins that Christ's love for us and giving his life as a sacrifice for us would set him free of a life of wickedness, depravity, disobedience, and sin. Amen? This is what Paul is speaking of, and this is what compels him. He has Christ's love in him, and his hope and prayer and call of God in his life is to share it with others. Share it with what? Meal's request to come and share God's word with you was that there may be one, two, a handful, maybe more in this place that have never come to the saving knowledge of Christ as Lord of their life, asking him to forgive them of their sins, their depravity, their disobedience to his word and his commands. It's for them, those perhaps in this place, again, one, two, a handful or more of you that say, you know what, today's the day that I confess with my mouth, I believe in my heart that Jesus is the Son of God, and that I fall on my face before him and ask for forgiveness. And I live for him and I walk in his ways. It is for Christ's love that compelled Paul to respond to the call to preach to the Corinths. And even of this place, Huntington. I knew I'd get it right after three times. What compels you in life? What is it drives you? What is your motive? I begin to think of that. Of everything that I do, of even this ice cream shop that my wife and I have invested so much in to open, what is it that has compelled us to do such a thing? And then when I'm asked, I often tell people, I want to continue in ministry and travel. I want to travel abroad and go places to support ministries. I want to teach leaders. I want to continue to minister to children, but I can't if I don't have a source of income to sustain myself, my family, and provide for travel. Ice cream shop. As I studied the business, has a huge return. Margins are great. And people can't turn down ice cream. Amen? Ah, it's a win-win. I dangled the worm before the fish. I said, God, provide for us a residual source of income, passive at best, that would allow my wife and I continue in ministry, because I am so compelled to share Christ's love. Wow. There's a motive behind everything I do. I begin to discover there is a motive behind everything I do. Every tank of gas and every mile I log, and every seat that is filled with students and parents and the few elderly you have here as well. Christ's love that compels. Oh, we got to go on. We got to continue. Here's what it says. Because. No. Back to verse 14. We're not finished. Because. I like because. You know, that's a conjunction word, isn't it? I could sing it here and many would join me. Conjunction, junction. Yeah, I knew it. I knew it. Yeah. See, I couldn't sing that at camp. You would have no idea, would you? Phew. Right over your head. But Brother Klein got it right off the bat. Because this is why, listen, this is why Paul and Timothy as well are so compelled to share Christ's love, because they are convinced. What are they? Convinced. Words have meaning. The word convinced means moved by evidence. I'm trying to wet my lips that I might whistle. See, at our church, of which I'm absent for today, I'm a lead pastor, and I didn't mention that in all the things I'm busy with, yeah. In my absence this morning, we're checking base, you know, as the minister there to deliver his word, is breakfast being served, are the chairs set up, who's running the sound, the video, and the audio, you know, my mind is there with them. We're convinced. The evidence, what's your evidence? You see, Paul has evidence. Can I share with you Paul's evidence? You see, if we go back to the book of Acts, if we go back to the book of what? Yeah, his name wasn't Paul in the book of Acts, it's Saul. What was his name? In the book of Acts, his name was Saul. He was a mercenary. He was a murderer. He was one who destroyed by orders, and many of them given himself or permission granted to destroy the early church. This place, those who gather in Christ's name, who call themselves devoted followers of Christ. His job and his mission was to destroy them, disperse them, disrupt their gatherings, and even at times take the very life of its members and those who lead it. He was a relentless bad dude. His name was Saul. And he was given orders to go to Damascus. It's in Syria, north of the border of what we know today as Israel. He was to go north to Damascus, where there's a group of people like this gathering in Christ's name. And he was to disrupt, disperse, and even, if have to, take the lives of those who gather in Christ's name. And on his way there, a bright light shined about him. threw him off his horse and onto the dusty path he lay. A bright light appeared, blinding him, and there he lay. The men with him were startled. As then Saul lays there, he hears a voice that says, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" There's only one who can address themselves that way in this context, and that is none other than Jesus Christ himself. Come on, that is none other than who? Jesus Christ himself. So what has allowed Paul to be given the title apostle? He witnessed the resurrected Christ and a challenge and a directive given him to continue, but not in the current work, but in a new work. The old would be gone and the new would come. As we'll see in a moment. Bright light shone about him and says, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" Saul was blinded by that experience. He was given instructions to go to a city nearby, a village nearby, and stay in a house on a street called Straight. And there, a few days had passed, his sight was restored. A visit from people of Christ. "I was blind, but now I see." Reminds me of some lyrics of an old hymn Paul could have sung himself. Paul had an experience with Christ so profound, so miraculous, so transformable that now the evidence of Christ's work in his life has so convinced him that others need to hear of Christ's love themselves. I fear too many people in this place and churches like it who gathered this morning, its members, its congregants, have never truly experienced Christ. And so they don't have this overwhelming, powerful urge within them to share his love with others. I just said that, Camille. I just said that. Until you have had an encounter with Christ so miraculous, so transformable, that you, who were once alive in sin, are now dead to it, and alive in Christ, and experience the old gone and the new coming, then how can you share that experience with others unless you yourself have experienced yourself and so compels you to share it? My hope and prayer for everybody is that you have that encounter with Christ that is so remarkable, so transformable, that you know that you no longer desire the former way of living. Oh, because that's what Paul says as we jump ahead in this. For the sake of time, and there's so much in this, again, it's a 12-ounce perfectly cooked steak or a 50-pound round weight. Let's jump ahead to verse 17. "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come, the old has gone, the new is here." This is what Paul is speaking of, and in the latter part of 14, 15, and 16, he's speaking of Christ's death, burial, and resurrection. It's encompassed within there, this hope in the message of Christ, that he's given us new life as well. Has he given you new life? Has he given you a new name? Has he so radically changed your life that you no longer live nor desire the things of the past? That the old man is gone, you've crucified the flesh, the former way of living now is no longer, it's dead, it's absent from your present time, or are you still living in that? And you do, it's so gray that there's no distinction between the two. I ask and pray that God radically mix you up, change you in such a way that you can say this: the old has gone, the new is here. I'm gonna be real with you. You didn't want the old Paul to come preach and teach and share your students. Am I right, Jess? Yeah. Because this is what you'd get. Oh, not there, the moose is occupying that space. That'd make for a very boring and slow program, wouldn't it? Too terrified to speak. Stomach rumbling and gurgling. Asking the ushers before service how far to the nearest restroom because I might need it halfway through our presentation this morning. Terrified. Fearful of even stepping on a place of this importance. A place to deliver God's word. I was what? Terrified. filled with fear of what others might think or say or how they'd view me or how I could present in a way that would draw people closer to Christ and not further from. I was challenged with it every time I was asked to share. But boy, when Christ got a hold of me and he changed me, I thank God the old is gone. I thank God the new has come, that there's boldness given by God through his Holy Spirit to us who follow him, that compels us, that inner urge, as we are convinced, if God did it in my life, he can do it in yours. He can transform you and change you, make you new. I want to challenge you with that thought before we close the song of worship this morning, because I know many kids at camp who would hear a message similar to this and then ask to go into their small groups and meet with their cabin leaders. And they would discuss, they would debrief, they would decompress, they would ask questions, they would pray with one another. And of that model, I've spoke so highly of you across the nation that no one does it better than Union Church. That you as cabin leaders, parents who give up a week of your time, a weekend, you volunteer, you sacrifice. I've seen where you live, but not eat. You eat good, but... those dank little cabins, you know what I'm saying? You give up your time to sleep on that cot that you could spend hours with these students to encourage them in their walk and their faith with Christ, and you've done just that. And we've seen many kids' lives transformed, have we not? Some of you who are now cabin leaders themselves, lives have been transformed. The old is gone, the new has come. As I pray, I'm going to challenge you. Search yourself, search your heart this morning. Have I had that encounter with Christ in such a way? Not so similar to that of Paul, where I've been thrown off my horse and blinded by a bright light and given directions of where to go to receive a miracle. But you know the cravings of the flesh, the sin that you desired, that living in the disobedience is, it's of the past. The old is gone, the new has come. If you've not experienced that this morning, ask God to give you that experience as you humbly fall on your face before him and say, Lord, forgive me of my sin. Forgive me of my disobedience. I confess you as Lord and Savior of my life. I believe in my heart that you truly are who you say you are in your word. You're the sacrifice, the price of which was paid for the penalty of my sin, and I receive that sacrifice, your shed blood, that I could live in victory, overcome as you did sin and death and reign with you and live with you in heaven forever and ever. We're co-heirs to the kingdom of heaven, where you prepared a place for us who believe in your name, that God, where you are, one day we will be there also. God, I thank you. I thank you for your forgiveness. We receive that this morning. The old is gone. The new has come. Let's be real. There might be some in here who have never prayed that prayer, and this morning are. Or you're rethinking the commitment you made years ago, perhaps even as a child at camp. You're saying, God, stir within me the compelling spirit to share this gospel, this hope, this good news with others in the workplace, my neighbors, the students I pass at school. Lord, compel me to share it, the message of hope with others, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you stand on your feet and sing this song with us this morning?
Holy.
us this opportunity and providing for us this place to gather in your name. Lord, I thank you for the sweet spirit of those that are here. People of which I call today more than friends, but family. I thank you, God, for the family that my family, my wife and daughters have experienced here. And God, I pray blessings upon this congregation. Continue to be with them, Lord, in this walk and this journey that they're on, as this community church reaching its friends and neighbors with the good news and the gospel of Jesus Christ. May nothing hinder that, Lord, we pray, that we all in this place would continue to raise your name, lifting it up, declaring it, proclaiming it to this community, that others would come and experience the hope that's found in Jesus Christ. Lord, thank you for our family, we pray. In Jesus' name, as you be seated, amen, amen, amen. I don't know who to call out, but Brother Klein would be the...
Sure.
He'd be the go-to.
So, what do you guys think? They felt a little bit like camp? Kids? Yeah. This is what we have. So, yeah, ladies and gentlemen, let's give them a round of applause for just bringing camp here to Union Church. I didn't do my homework. How many years has it been? Has it been 15, 16?
Lily was...
Camille?
Lily was three. She's almost 17.
Okay, all right.
So that's eight.
Yep, so this has been what's happening. And you are a handsome 27-year-old man. So, yeah, exactly. All right.
Call like I see it.
But, yeah, so these guys have invested really heavily into our kids and our youth ministry for so, so long. So, yeah, let's give them one more hand for being here today. So. Yeah.
Thank you so much.
All right, well, we are going to shift gears into picnic mode. So we are going to have a picnic here just to enjoy our camp feel. So there is going to be drinks over there, or there will be drinks over there, and there's hot dogs over there. If you didn't bring food and you want to stick around, we'll set some tables up here. So if you want to help with that as well, the park is open, and you can grab a chair and head over there and just enjoy one another's company. And, yeah, make camp come alive. I think there's a Gaga ball pit outside as well and Nine Square, because those are two serious camp things that we do all the time. So anyway, thanks for coming today. Thanks for being a part of our camp service.